Good morning, FCC. Let's stand and worship.
There's no God. There's no God like our God. No other name is worthy of all our praise. The rock of salvation that cannot be moved. Himself to be faithful and true. There is no rock, there is no God like ours. There is no rock, there is no God like our God. No other name is worthy of all our praise. The rock of salvation that cannot be moved. Proving himself to be faithful and true. There is no rock, there is no God like ours. Rock of ages, Jesus is the rock. Rock of ages, Jesus is the rock. Rock of ages. There is no rock, there is no God like God. There is no rock, there is no God like our God. No other name is worthy of all our praise. The rock of salvation that cannot be moved. Of ages, Jesus is.
is like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. Like the sound of a symphony to my ears. Like holy water on my skin.
Dead men walking, slave to sin. I want to know about being born again. I need you. Oh God, I need you. So take me to
guys. Michaela Love here, your children's minister here at FCC. I've got your announcements for the week. Tonight at 6:30, there will be a bonfire at Debbie Seifert's house for all the FCC women. We'd love to see you there. Also tonight, we have the high school Bible study that will be at the Poston's house from 5 to 6 p.m. We're already looking ahead to next year, so if you want to have offering envelopes for 2022, contact the church office and we'll get you signed up for those. We do need all of those signups done by the end of this month, so go ahead and get those in. Our 7th and 8th grade students have the opportunity to go to The Forge. That is an overnight conference at Lincoln Christian University. That's going to be October 29th and 30th this year. If you'd like for your students to go, you can go ahead and register them online at lincolnchristian.edu. The student ministry is going to be having a rake and run on November 6th. So go ahead and meet at the student ministry building at 9 o'clock and bring a rake. We'd love to see you there. Guys, we're getting ready for Christmas already. Operation Christmas Child, all the boxes, information, all of that will be in the lobby. So go ahead and grab a box and look into it. We'd love to have you participate. We just want to remind everyone there will be an affirmation on October 31st over the Sunday school hour for Trevor Higgins as the worship minister and Sarah Hogan as a student minister. Guys, Trunk or Treat is next week. We are so excited for the opportunity to be able to do things in our community, and we'd love to see you guys participate. That is next Wednesday, October 27th from 6 to 7:30. If you signed up to do a trunk, or if you signed up to help us out just to float around and manage the flow of the event, we ask that you be in place and ready to receive students by 5:45. We've been talking about volunteer signups for the last several weeks. I'm going to go ahead and leave those signup sheets in the back of the auditorium just in case there's a couple more people that want to sign up. But I just want to personally thank each and every one of you that said yes, because we have met the majority of our staffing shortages in just those few short weeks. And so I just want to genuinely say thank you and make it clear, like, to you guys that you know just how important and huge that this is. Your one week, a month, or your once a quarter commitment is huge, and we're so grateful for all the ways that our congregation said yes in the last few weeks. Those are all of our announcements for the week. Now I'm gonna go ahead and introduce our guest speaker. His name is Dr. Pete Vercruzzi. He's coming from Lincoln Christian University. He's currently serving as the Vice President of Academics over at LCU. I had the opportunity to get to know him personally during my time as a student. He was one of my professors, as well as working 5 years in the office over at LCU. We worked pretty directly together. So it's my honor to be able to introduce him for us today. He's the author of 3 books, but he says that his main vocation is loving Jesus and letting others know that Jesus loves them too.
All right, thanks to Michaela. I don't know if she's here to hear this live or whether she'll hear it later, but she asked me to send her a bio, and I did, and I said she could use all of it, none of it, or just make stuff up. And you understand when you ask a former student to do that, that's an act of faith. Okay? But no, I really enjoyed having Michaela as a student and working with her in the registrar's office, and I know that our loss has been your gain here. And I also want you to know we've been in prayer for you at LCU this week, and Ryan, for you and your family, the whole LCU family's been lifting you up in prayer. Once I saw a little boy proudly show his mother a painting he'd made at school. She looked at it and turned it this way and that, and then looked some more. "Why, it's lovely, just lovely," she murmured, and suddenly she exclaimed, "Oh, I see what it is. It's a house and a tree, and there's a big sun." And then the little boy grabbed the paper and bunched it all up, and he hollered, "That's not what I meant." Did you ever, oh, so carefully, lay out just how things were and how they worked and why they worked, and then sat back satisfied? Then you heard someone repeat what you'd said, oh so carefully, and you hardly recognized it. And your brain screamed, "That's not what I meant." Did you ever pry out of your heart, your mind, a tiny nugget of how you truly felt? And then told someone, probably someone special. And then stared in disbelief as he responded wrong, all wrong. And, And your every pore shouted, "That's not what I meant." Sometimes, smug times, when I'm talking about God, when I'm praying to God, when I'm working for God, sometimes, smug times, when I'm very busy in the church, about the church, around the church, I wonder if God isn't sighing or whispering or saying or even hollering, "That's not what I meant." I first read that meditation back when I was a teenager in a little book called God is No Fool by Lois Chaney. But in recent weeks and months, my mind and my heart have gone back to that again as I've been thinking more and more lately about the question, what does it mean to be the church? And I want to speak about that question this morning and to examine how in the first two chapters of the book of Acts, Luke speaks to that question. So if you have your Bibles with you this morning, I'd like you to turn them to the book of Acts. I'm not going to read our passage together because I really want to look at an overview of these entire first two chapters. And I don't want to take the time to read all of that together. But I have to confess, as I dwell on this portion of Scripture, and as I reflect upon that question, I sometimes wonder whether God does not look upon what we have made of the church today and want to say to us, "That's not what I meant." For example, okay, and you can help me out here. This is participation activity, right? You know how to do this, okay? Got to get your hands up there and get them out. Come on, help me out here. Okay, and you know how this works. You put your fingers together. You've done this before. You learned it in junior church. This is the church. Here's the steeple. Open the doors. See all the people, right? Like, I mean, you love it, right? It's fun. It's cute. We do it all the time. But here's lesson number one today. And we're going to do this game show style. I want you to help me to fill in the blanks on this next slide up here. Okay? See if you can guess what goes in the blanks. The church is the people, not the building. The church is the people, not the building. Now that's a very simple truth, a very fundamental truth. Foundational truth, and yet there is absolutely no way to articulate a biblical answer to the question, what does it mean to be the church, until we have that premise in place. See, the very first church was never confused about this because they didn't have any buildings with which to confuse themselves. They understood that there is no such thing as a Christian without a church because Christians are the church. And to become the church means that we answer the call to follow Jesus. And in community with other followers of Jesus, we become a particular kind of people. So the critical question, the question the apostles addressed, that Luke addresses here in Acts, is as God's church, what kind of a people does God call us to be? And as we look at the first two chapters here in the book of Acts, we see, first of all, that God has called us to be a people with a message. Now, if we were to survey people and ask them the question, you know, what happens in the first two chapters of Acts? We might hear a number of different answers because there's so much that transpires here. The person of Jesus ascends, the Spirit of Jesus descends. But in the midst of all of that, there is one event that stands at the heart of everything else. For the very first time in the history of planet Earth, the gospel is preached. The good news about the death and the burial and the resurrection of Jesus and the offer of salvation to every one of us is proclaimed for everyone to hear. Just as Jesus himself had prophetically foretold on that day in Caesarea Philippi when he asked his disciples, "Who do you say that I am?" And it was Peter who stepped forward to answer, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God," to which Jesus replied, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by man, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And so now, on this day of Pentecost, we find at the heart of these chapters this monumental sermon preached by this same Peter, who on that former occasion had been told by Jesus not to tell anyone yet that Jesus was the Christ. But now he's announcing the fulfillment of this prophecy. Now he is recalling the miracles and the wonders and the signs, now witnessing to the resurrection of the one God raised to life, and now proclaiming for everyone to hear that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. And through the power of the Spirit and the power of that message, the church is born. And he, that Jesus, whom God has made both Lord and Christ, becomes our message to the world. Because the message isn't just about an idea, is it? It's about a person. There is nowhere in these chapters where we can escape the presence of this person. They begin with Christ risen, who becomes Christ ascended, who pours out his Spirit upon his people to empower them to become his witnesses. I remember my very first day in Bible college, my very first Bible class. It was called Introduction to the Bible, probably because that was the very first Bible class, right? Introduction to the Bible. And to this day, I remember how my professor tried to put that course in perspective for us. He said, think of it this way. The world is lost, and you have been given a book that contains a roadmap, an escape route. Your job is to find that escape route and lead the world out. Now, I want us to think about that for a minute, because we live in a world that is so lost, it doesn't even know it's lost. I mean, of all the people in the world, of all the people on this planet, we are the people with whom God has entrusted the only message that can save this world. And we live in a bad news world, don't we? Does a day ever really go by when we don't hear the bad news about another school shooting, or the bad news about a possible nuclear missile strike or a foreign war, the bad news about trade wars, the bad news about vanishing retirement funds, the bad news about unaffordable health care, the bad news about hyperinflation, the bad news about a pandemic that just refuses to go away? And if such a day ever comes and we don't hear such news, it's rare, because if we listen to the news networks long enough, we learn soon enough that if it isn't bad, it isn't news. Or maybe it's more personal. Maybe it's the bad news of a friend who's lost a job, or the bad news from a family member whose marriage has just disintegrated, or the bad news from a loved one who's been diagnosed with cancer. And the Church of Acts, understand this, the Church of Acts also lived in a world full of bad news. I mean, when you wake up every morning to live yet another day under the military occupation of your Roman conquerors, that was bad news. Suffering and persecution at the hands of your own synagogue or your Sanhedrin or even of Caesar, that was bad news. But what we need to understand, I believe, is this, that this is precisely where, as the church, we find our calling. For God has always called his church, just as God calls us today, calls you and calls me, to be a good news people in a bad news world. Jesus never promised to protect any of us, not even his disciples, from all of the trials and the tribulations and the troubles of life. In fact, he assured us in John chapter 16, he said, in this world you will have trouble. But in that very same chapter, that very verse, he also encouraged us, but take heart, I have overcome the world. And he promised to us a peace that none of those troubles or trials or tribulations can take away. You see, the good news is that I serve a king whose kingdom is not of this world. And I live by the promise that the one who lives in me is greater than the one who is in the world. I live for a kingdom, a king whose kingdom, the author of Hebrews tells me, cannot be shaken. So even if you take away my job, you can't shake that kingdom. Even if you take away my house or close my bank account, you still can't shake that kingdom. Even if you take my health away from me, you still can't shake that kingdom. You can even take the people whom I love the most, but you can't shake that kingdom. Because God has made this Jesus, whom I serve, both Lord and Christ. And the good news, Peter tells us, is that his cross is God's great plus over all of life's minuses. And his empty tomb means that my life will not end with a question mark, but with an exclamation point. Because Jesus Christ is Lord. He sits on the throne of his universe. He holds all of history in his hands. And nothing that happens in this world can ever change that. That is the good news. That is our message. And that is the only source of hope for this world. To be the church. To be a people with a message. But we also see in these chapters that to be the church is to be a people with a mission. People with a mission. I believe that one of the most common and really the most important questions that people have when it comes to the Bible is, where do I fit in? You know, the Bible contains all of these stories about all of these people, Adam and Eve and Noah and Abraham and Moses and Peter and Paul. But you know, their world seems so different and their experiences so different. Their stories so different from ours. Harry Emerson Fosdick, the first great radio preacher in America, once said, "The people don't wake up every day looking forward to next Sunday morning because they can't wait to find out what happened to the Jebusites." We want to know, where does our story fit into God's plan and God's word? And I believe the answer to that question begins with an understanding that the Bible is really one story, one big story. It's an epic story. An epic love story. To borrow some language from the Christian writer Vaughn Roberts, it all begins with the pattern of the kingdom. Okay? God's people living in God's presence, under God's rule, in God's blessing. Okay? Because that's what you find in the opening chapter. And that's what the kingdom of God is. God's people living in God's presence, under God's rule and God's blessing. In this garden paradise of perfect relationships, God with people, people with each other, man with woman, and people with creation. But then that kingdom perishes, the perished kingdom, as people decide not only to become lawbreakers, but their own lawmakers, and to take God's place on the throne of their lives. And because they rejected God's rule, they were removed from God's presence and separated from God's blessing. And all of those perfect relationships perish. But God, in his unfailing love for us, refuses to let us go. And so he calls a man named Abraham. And in his covenant with Abraham, you find a promised kingdom in the form of three promises: that Abraham's descendants will become a nation, that God will provide a land for that nation, and finally, that through Abraham's descendants, God will bless all the peoples of the earth. As God fulfills the first two of those promises, a partial kingdom emerges as Abraham's family grows into the nation of Israel, and God provides the land of Canaan as a home. But Israel proves unfaithful to God and refuses to repent of her idolatry, and God removes his prospering and protective hand, and Israel again is taken away into captivity, removed from God's presence and separated from God's blessing. But still, in his unfailing love, God refuses to let us go. And so a prophesied kingdom continues to find hope in that third promise, hope that God will send his promise to send into the world a descendant of Abraham, a servant, a savior, a prophet, a priest, and a king, through whom God will bless all the peoples of the earth. And in his unfailing love, for God so loved the world, he rescued a remnant of that people, return to the land, and Jesus Christ is born. And in his life and through his death and resurrection, the kingdom of God begins to be made present, the present kingdom in this world once again. And then this story becomes our story, because God's promise was not just to bless Israel. He promised, and I quote the words to Abraham from Genesis 12:3, all peoples on earth will be blessed through you. And yet Jesus, even though he lived his life for us all and gave his life for us all, lived that entire life in a geographical area about 70 miles tall and 45 miles wide. And so he tells his church in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, and you will be my witnesses, not only in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. And understand there that Jesus clearly and purposely invokes the same language that God used in his third promise to Abraham, because this is how the Bible story becomes our story. This is where my life fits in. See, the present kingdom must become a proclaimed kingdom until Jesus comes again to make it a perfect kingdom. You see, everything that God has done in his entire salvation in history, everything that God has done through Noah, through Abraham, through Moses, through the prophets, through the apostles, has all been part of God's plan to prepare from this moment, to prepare for our place in his history. This time when his church, his Holy Spirit-empowered people, can take the good news about what he has done for us in Christ to the ends of the earth. Has it ever occurred to you that on that day so long ago, so many, many years ago, when God spoke to Abraham, that even in that moment, God was already planning to use you and me to keep that promise? Believe it or not, I used to run on the track team back in high school, and I learned that when you partner with teammates in a relay race, the highest privilege was to run the anchor position, because that meant that you would have the privilege, especially if you won, of carrying the baton across the finish line. Human history is in the home stretch, and we're running anchor because we are the ones who have been called not just to run the race, but to finish the race. Now, some might say, well, you know, if we're in the home stretch, it sure seems like we're taking a long enough time to get to the finish line. But I want you to remember what Peter said when the critics of his day asked him, where is this coming he promised? And Peter replied, first of all, with the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like a day. So 2,000 years, I guess, basically for God, it's just been a long weekend. Okay? But he also wrote this, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. You see, if God was willing to wait patiently, and that is what provides us with this opportunity to share the good news. And I want to admit to you, I have moments when I just wish Jesus would come back, like right now. There are days when I say, Jesus, come back. Bring John Wayne with you, too, because you know, we're going to start taking names and kicking down doors. But come back, you know, vindicate your name, vindicate your son, vindicate your people. But what gives me pause is that I also understand that if Jesus were to come back today, there are people I love who will not be seen in heaven because their opportunity to respond to God's invitation will be over. And though God calls us to work long and hard if that's what is necessary and go to the ends of the earth if that is what is required, we don't always have to look to the ends of the earth to find people who need to respond to that invitation. Sometimes we just need to look to the end of the block. Sometimes just to the end of the dinner table. The Bible teaches us that the coming of Jesus is constantly imminent. That means it's possible any day and impossible no day. The opportunity of tomorrow is never promised to us. We have today. That's why we are called to be a people on a mission. And I believe it's well past time to recover a sense of urgency about that. Well, finally, to be the church means even more than just being a people with a message, even more than just being a people with a mission. It also means to be a people who live as members one of another. Now, I borrow that language from Paul in Romans 12, but I also believe that the reality embodied in that language is evident here in these first two chapters of Acts. When chapter 1 begins, you notice, we find the apostles, 1:6 says, together with each other and with the Lord. After Jesus ascends, they return to Jerusalem together, where they meet in an upper room together. And verse 14 tells us they all joined together constantly in prayer along with the women and the brothers. In verse 15, 120 of them are together as Peter leads them through the process of choosing someone to replace Judas among the 12. Chapter 2 opens just a few verses later, and we read in verse 1 that when the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. And it was while they were together that they were filled with the Holy Spirit. And then together they began to speak in other languages so that each member of the crowd heard what was being said in his own native language. And even after the 3,000 baptisms that followed Peter's sermon, we read beginning in chapter 2, verse 42, about how they devoted themselves to what it meant to live out their lives together as a community of believers. Verse 42, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. That means they learned and studied together. They served and they socialized together. They ate in each other's homes together. They met around the Lord's table together. They prayed and they worshiped together. And in verse 44, we read all the believers were together. Verse 46, they continued to meet together. They even shared their possessions with each other when someone had a need. And they became a people so bound together by their common faith in Jesus and their common love for one another that they actually participated in each other's lives. Now, I believe we need to think about what that means in the context of a world that ironically worries about the dangers of overpopulation at the same time that people suffer from loneliness in epidemic proportions. We live in a world where we can find a bar in every neighborhood because people believe that weekends are made for Michelob. And after all, sometimes you just want to go where somebody knows your name. We live in a world filled with people who are longing for the kind of community that can be found in an accepting and loving fellowship because we all have a human longing in our hearts to know and be known, to love and be loved. God made us that way. And the tragedy is that it is just so typical of our superficial society to settle for a cheap counterfeit, to settle for escape rather than reality, in a place that dispenses liquor instead of grace, and all for the price of just a few beers, but all the time missing out on the life-changing reality that God desperately invites people to experience. Now, I've heard it said that our problem is not so much that our churches are filled with empty seats, but that our seats are full of empty people. I'm afraid that that far too often is exactly what happens when we permit a few minutes over coffee and a donut once a week to define the boundaries of our fellowship instead of acting in participation in each other's lives. But see, when the message and the mission come together in the people who live out what it means to be members of one another, then people can experience the life-changing, transforming power of the grace of God. Because in the end, the good news isn't just about what will happen someday. The good news is also about what can happen every day when people experience the power of God's grace. I'm going to close with two stories. Tales of Two Preachers. They're very different stories. Because even preachers, you know, have their favorite preachers. Until he died just a few years ago, the preacher I most loved to hear and would every time I had the opportunity was Fred Craddock, professor of preaching in New Testament at Candler School of Theology. And he once told this story about the first church where he ever served. First little church I served was in the eastern Tennessee hills, not too far from Oak Ridge. When Oak Ridge began to boom with atomic energy, that little bitty town became a booming city just overnight. Every hill and every valley and every shady grove had recreational vehicles and trucks and things like that. People came in from everywhere, pitched tents, lived in wagons, hard hats from everywhere, with their families and their children pedaling around in the mud in those trailer parks, lived in everything temporarily just to work. Our church was not far away. We had a beautiful little church building white frame building, 112 years old. The church had an organ in the corner, which one of the young fellows had to pump while Miss Lois played it, and boy, she could play the songs just as slow as anybody. The organ was a little slow. Church had beautifully decorated chimneys, kerosene lamps all around the walls, and every pew in this little church was hewn, hand-hewn from a giant poplar tree. After church one Sunday morning, I asked the leaders to stay, and I said to them, now we need to launch a calling campaign, an invitational campaign to all these trailer parks to invite these people to church. Oh, I don't know. I don't think they'd fit in here, one of them said. They're just here temporarily. They're just construction people. They'll be leaving pretty soon. Well, we ought to invite them and make them feel at home, I said. We argued about it. Time ran out. And we said we'd vote next Sunday. Next Sunday, we all sat down after the service. I moved, said one of them. I moved that in order to be a member of this church, you must own property in the county. Someone else said, I second that, and it passed. I voted against it, but they reminded me that I was just a kid preacher, and I didn't have a vote, and it passed. When we moved back to these parts, I took my wife to see that little church, because I had told her that painful, painful story. The roads have changed. The interstate goes through that part of the country, so I had a hard time finding it, but I finally did. I found the state road, then the county road, and then the little gravel road. And then there, back among the pines, was that building, still shining white, but it was different. The parking lot was full of motorcycles and trucks and cars packed in there. And out front, a great big sign, barbecue, all you can eat. It's a restaurant, so we went inside. The pews are against a wall. They have electric lights now, and the organ pushed over into the corner. There are all these aluminum and plastic tables, and people sitting there eating barbecued pork and chicken and ribs. All kinds of people. Parthians, Medes, Edomites, dwellers of Mesopotamia. All kinds of people. And I said to Nettie, his wife, it's a good thing this is not still a church. Otherwise, these people couldn't be in here. Another preacher I've long admired lived back in the 1700s. He was a self-taught man, orphaned at the age of 12, who at one point in his young life made the decision to become a preacher. But that was not as easy as it sounds, because at the time he was apprenticed to a tailor in the village of Bradford, England. And his apprenticeship kept him constantly occupied from 6 a.m. to 8 p.m. every day. That left him little time for learning, but he soon mastered the Christian literary classic, Pilgrim's Progress, and began to accustom himself to public speaking. Eventually, a small Baptist church in Waynesgate, invited this, Waynesville here in Illinois, okay, this was in England, but in Waynesgate, invited this young, self-taught preacher to come and serve as their minister. Now, in truth, Waynesgate wasn't even a village. It was just kind of a group of houses on the top of a hill, but the men in that little community had gathered there. They decided to build a house of worship. It was a small, plain, and simple structure, no furniture, just stools, and it would only hold about 100 people. By and large, the members of this church were poor and uneducated, but the congregation began to grow, and soon they had to build a galley to hold more people. Of course, before long, you know what happened. The bigger churches in London began to hear about this successful young preacher, and one of them invited him to move to the sprawling city of London and preach there. He visited, they met, and he accepted their invitation. He was all ready to leave his ministry in Waynesgate. He announced his decision to the church. His family had packed for the journey. He had even preached his farewell sermon and sold his books and bulky furniture that would be hard to move. And then when the day of her departure came, a two-wheel wagon came for the remaining possessions, his family of four children. And there, gathered around to meet him, and sent him on his way with tears in their eyes, with every single member of that church. And one by one, John Fawcett sent his wife and children back down off the cart, and he decided to stay. And John Fawcett preached in Wainscate, England for 54 years. The next Sunday, that congregation would sing a hymn written by their own preacher, a hymn that he wrote just for them. And it's a song that's familiar to us, a song that I invite us to sing together this morning. We're going to sing this without accompaniment because I believe that many of you know it. But it's a song that celebrates what happens when the message and the mission come together and a church lives out what it means to be members of one another. Will you sing it with me? Blessed be the tie that binds our hearts in Christian love, the fellowship of kindred minds is like to that above. Before our Father's throne, we pour our ardent prayers, our fears, our hopes, our aims are one, our comforts and our cares. When we asunder part, it gives us inward pain, but we will still be joined in heart and hope to meet again. And all God's people said, amen. Amen.
How great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my down from glory.
Seat, if you would get your communion out and ready. The fellowship of believers proved to be as important as it's ever been in my life this last week. Truly experiencing the words that Paul wrote to the church in Corinth about this unity and fellowship when he said, if one member suffers, all suffer together. If one member is honored, all rejoice together. I was reading about John Fawcett, the author of this hymn that we just sang together this week, and who does such a thing? Staying in such a poor community with this church. Let me just give you some more perspective, if you don't mind. First, about the church that he turned down. The church that he almost left for in London. It was considered the most influential of its time. John Gill, the author of New Testament and Old Testament Exposition, still much in use today, had been the pastor there for 51 years, and the church later became Metropolitan Tabernacle, pastored by Charles Spurgeon. I'm sure the pay was better at such a church, because where he stayed in Waynesgate, his salary was estimated at never more than $200 per year, supplemented by potatoes and wool. But a people fellowship kept him there. It sounds familiar to me, only opposite. If you don't mind, I'd like to just interact with a scripture with you for just a second. Scripture from Philippians that Paul wrote. But backwards, see. This temptation to leave something so humble and small for something so much greater with so much more honor. We read about another pastor's heart. Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant and being born in the likeness of men. What do you think that send-off was like? Have you ever thought about that? Jesus leaving his Father and this host in heaven to come here. Why? He came to be obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. And God therefore exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that the name of Jesus, at that name, every knee would bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of the Father. Our living hope. So today, why would we not worship together in fellowship, in unity, around this table and around these elements, celebrating, remembering, and proclaiming with one voice the death of our Savior and the promise of life in him. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and said, "This is covenant, a new covenant, and my blood poured out for you. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." Father God, we thank you for your love for us. We thank you for how you chose to show and embody that love in our lives through Jesus Christ. We thank you for these elements that we celebrate together, that we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again for us. Father, we long for that day. And in the meantime, we cling to our hope in Jesus and to the fellowship of the believers. In his name, amen.
The joy of seeing a child open the boxes for the first time is just, it's incredible.
There's squeals and screams, and they are so excited to see what's inside their box.
Oh my goodness!
Every shoebox gift represents the love of God to them.
We are so excited. Many of the children receive the shoebox for the first time in their life.
We're here with Operation Christmas Child. The kids are so excited. We had the opportunity to hand out some of the boxes. There's so much joy, so much happiness, and it gives us an opportunity to present the gospel. We pray that these boxes will be used to bring a lot of happiness and joy, but more importantly, the gospel to each heart, all these little children around the world.
What a great gift. I get a present. I get to know who Jesus is, but not only that, I get to be discipled in his ways.
Hundreds of thousands of volunteers work with Operation Christmas Child every year, preparing these boxes, praying for the boxes, that God will use them in a mighty way for his glory.
This little shoebox has the opportunity to change the world. Not only are they going to get a shoebox, they're going to get the love and the message of Jesus Christ.
Some go by helicopter, some go by ship, some go by camel, donkeys, canoes. We go at great lengths to take these boxes to children in the most remote parts of the world, and it's an incredible journey.
After these children open the box, they have the opportunity to go through the greatest journey, the 12-lesson discipleship program, where they get to learn more about Jesus Christ.
Right now, I'm right outside of Mazatlan, Mexico, about 6-hour drive up in the mountains. This is an indigenous people group, people that never heard the gospel before. The kids and the families that accepted Christ, almost 100 altogether, have now started a church.
Hemos visto una experiencia preciosa, grande, ¿verdad? En el pueblo. Y ese pueblo va a ser el medio para llevar el evangelio a otro lugar. Que estas bendiciones que son de las cajitas sigan llegando hacia arriba y a la montaña.
This shoebox gives us an opportunity to continue to shine the bright light of the gospel in the darkest and remote places around the world.
We're seeing families come to know Jesus. Churches are sprouting up in these communities. These children are rising up to be disciples in their own country.
The gift box and the gospel of Jesus Christ bring hope to our children to bring the smiles back on their faces.
No greater need and no greater time than right now for us to go out and serve boldly. This is what these shoeboxes are all about, to go out and the bring of hope of Jesus Christ around the world.
I'm just so amazed at what God does each and every year. This is an opportunity to impact the lives of millions of children, just like you've seen. But we need more boxes for next year. Every box is an opportunity for us to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. So thank you, and God bless each and every one.
That's a mission and a ministry that we've partnered with for many years. And so if you would like to participate, you can get a shoebox today. You can get more information about that just on the east side of our lobby over along the wall. There's a table there with all the information you need. And so just think about, pray about filling a shoebox and bringing it back so that we can deliver that message of hope. This Christmas. And there's a couple of other things I want to mention before we pray for our offering today. One is I want to remind you next Sunday during our education hour, during our Sunday school hour in between services, Trevor Higgins and Sarah Hogan, there's going to be an affirmation for both of them, for Trevor as worship minister and Sarah as student minister. And I just want to invite you to please be a part of that, to hear from them, to hear their heart and their passion for those ministries, and then also to participate in the affirmation that day. So that's next Sunday during the middle hour. And then also the women's bonfire event for tonight. Obviously, it would be a wet, smoky fire. And so they are moving it to the church lobby. Same time, but it'll be here at the church instead of out at the Cypher. So we hope you can still be a part of that, ladies. If you'll stand with me, I'm going to pray for our offering as we end our time in worship. Father, we pray that as we give this morning, whether it's in the bucket, whether it's online, whether we text to give, however we give to you today, we do it as an act of release, Father. We hold tight to nothing of this world, but cling to our hope in Jesus. So, Father, we pray that as we give today, that we would do it cheerfully, that we would do it selflessly, Father, and that it would bless you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Tell you about my Jesus. desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way.
FCC.